بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com Your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed explained from the book Aqidatul Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
The next chapter, which is chapter 8, the Sheikh says the ruling regarding someone who claims himself to be part of the atheistic thoughts or the parties that have kufr in them, that have means or rulings of the jahiliyyah, the ignorance times, the parties which are known nowadays, whether it is communist, whether it is Ba'athist, whether it is whatever you might call it, those parties, what is the ruling regarding attributing oneself to them or being a member in them? The Sheikh says to attribute oneself to such ways like communism or secularism or capitalism or other ways of kufr is an action of rejecting Islam, riddah. Riddah means to reject Islam. So if someone attributes himself or associates himself with such ways, then to claim that he is a Muslim is a great hypocrisy. A great hypocrisy. If someone says, I am a socialist and I am a Muslim, then he is a big hypocrite. He is not a Muslim. Because hypocrites, even though they believed kufr in their hearts, but apparently they were saying they are Muslims and they were praying, even they were praying congregation prayers. They would come to Fajr prayer sometimes and pray. They would come in the battle and fight with the Muslims against the kafirs, but still they are kafirs in their hearts. They disbelieve in their hearts as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has exposed them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the hypocrites, if they were to meet the believers, they would say, we are believers like you. And if they were to be alone with their devils, they would say, we are with you. We were just mocking the believers. This is verse 14, Surah Al-Baqarah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the hypocrites also, those people wait for the moment of difficulty and hardship for you. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for you a conquer, then they say, we are with you. Weren't we with you? They say, weren't we with you? Meaning, give us some of the booties. And if they saw that the kafirs won over you, they would tell the kafirs. They would go and tell the kafirs, didn't we support you? Didn't we prevent the believers from harming you? And things like that. This is verse 141, Surah An-Nisa. So those deceiving hypocrites, each of them has two faces. A face by which he meets the believers, and a face by which he meets his brothers amongst the atheists and the kafirs. And indeed he has two tongues, one by which he tries to make himself acceptable to the Muslims, apparently, and the other he translates by it what's in his heart, what is hidden in his heart, the true thing, the true face. That is when he meets with the kafirs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about them, as I mentioned in verse 14, Surah Al-Baqarah. So the hypocrites, upon turning away from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, belittling those two references and belittling the followers of the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they refused to follow the rule of the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they became happy with that which they claim to be knowledge that they have in their hands. So actually they are mocking the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah described them also in Surah Al-Baqarah verse 15. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah mocks them as a reward for their mockery. And Allah's mockery to them is that He make them go further into astray or into misguidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers to ally themselves with the believers and to attribute themselves to the faithful. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ittaqullaha wa kunu ma'as sadiqin. O you who believe in Allah, be aware of Allah and be with the truthful. Be with the truthful. So it is an order from Allah that a Muslim should attribute himself to the believers only, to the truthful only. This is verse 119, Surah At-Tawbah. And those astray ways that we mentioned, like communism and so on, they are fighting within themselves and amongst themselves, because they are all established on falsehood. The communism denies even the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fights all the heavenly religions. And anyone who accepts for himself to live without a belief and denies the sure concepts of belief, then he is actually ruling out his mind and ruling out his thinking. Also, the secularism denies the religions and depends upon materialism. And materialism has no goal but to live in this life a kind of animals living, just to eat and drink and so on. And capitalism is a way where the main concern is how to make money from whatever way, and they don't abide by any rules of halal and haram or mercy to the poor and needy. And the main or the cornerstone of their economy is riba, usury. That is actually considered to be fighting Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is a cause of destruction of whole countries and societies and people, and to suck the blood of the poor people everywhere. Those kinds of wicked ways have conquered the Muslim countries, when in most of those Muslim countries the true religion has been forgotten and the people lived on blind following for whatever they see. Then the Sheikh says, to associate oneself to the parties and to the nationalities based on distinction between tongues or colors or whatever, those are all jahiliyyah, meaning they follow the concepts of the times of ignorance. So to associate oneself to such parties is kufr, and it is a rejection of the religion of Islam, because Islam completely rejects such kinds of discrimination and the ways of the people of ignorance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O mankind, we have created you from a male and female, and we have made you people and tribes so that you recognize each other. The most honorable amongst you to Allah is the most pious amongst you. So there is no distinction in Islam but the distinction of piety. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he is not of us, he who calls to any asabiyyah. Asabiyyah means a distinction based on ignorance, based on color, based on language, whatever. وَلَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ قَاتَلَ عَلَىٰ عَصَبِيَّةِ. And he is also not amongst us, or not from us, he who fights on the basis of such a way, that is to make a distinction on the basis of ignorance, on the basis of color, on the basis of language, rather than on the basis of faith and piety. And also, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ غَضِبَ لِعَصَبِيَّةِ. He is not one of us who becomes angry, not for the sake of Allah, not for the sake of religion, not for the sake of following Quran and Sunnah, but for the sake of asabiyyah, which is to make distinctions on false basis. This is narrated by Muslim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in another hadith, Allah has wiped away from you the asabiyyah of the time of ignorance, and he wiped away from you the false pride, the pride by the fathers and grandfathers and ancestors. This is a false pride. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّمَا هُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ تَقِيٌّ أَوْ فَاجِرٌ شَقِيٌّ. It is either a pious believer or a miserable disbeliever. There is nothing else, no other distinction, no other distinction about the people. It's either a mu'minun taqi or fajirun shaqi, a pious believer or a miserable disbeliever. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, all mankind are sons of Adam, and Adam has been created from dust, and there is no preference for an Arab over a non-Arab, except by piety. So those kinds of parties which exist nowadays, based on astray thoughts, actually split the Muslims. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered the Muslims to unite on that which is good, and to unite on piety, and forbade us from splitting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all together, and do not separate. And remember the bounty of Allah upon you when you were enemies, and then he made your hearts one and close to each other. So by his bounty you became brothers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be one party, and that is the party of Allah. As Allah says in Quran, أَلَا إِنَّ حِزْبَ اللَّهِ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. حزب الله means the party of Allah, one party, not parties. We don't have parties. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said also in another hadith, this is not the mentioning of the Shaykh, but I mention it, that he said, لَا حِلْفَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. There are no sub-parties within Islam. Islam is a party by itself. So why should we make parties within a party? This is from Jahiliyyah, and this leads to splitting amongst Muslims. The Sheikh says, the Islamic world, after being conquered by Europe politically and culturally, they submitted to those false parties and false thoughts, and they took such false thoughts as something which is taken for granted and something which is true. And therefore, the people of those Muslim countries started to strangely follow the revival of what Allah and His Messenger has forbidden us, and that is the false asabiyas or the false loyalties. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stated that He has done a favor to us, that He took us out from such a corruption, then we are now doing that which makes us go back to that corruption. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِصْلَاحِهَا. لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِصْلَاحِهَا. Do not make corruption in this land of yours after Allah has made it good, after Allah has fixed it with the true religion, with the true faith, with the true path. The Shaykh says, it is natural that the believer forgets an old ignorancy and that he doesn't remember it, and when he remembers it, he only remembers it with hatred. This is the way the believer should be. This is the natural way of the believer. For example, a prisoner, when he is set free, if he remembers the hardship that he was in, his body would shake and tremble due to the bad feeling that he feels upon remembering the times that he was in the prison. So the Muslim and the believer should feel bad when he remembers the time of ignorance in the past that the Muslims were, or before that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in His book that He is all able to send upon you a punishment. The Shaykh says, such kinds of splits on false basis and such kinds of false loyalties is a punishment from Him. It's a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of our sins, of course. So we sin with regular sins, which we know that they are sins. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a reward or as a result for those sins, He makes us fall into more deviancy by either enrolling into innovations or into false loyalties or whatever. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, He is all able to send a punishment upon you from above you, from underneath your feet, or make you parties, and making you taste one another's torture and punishment. This is in verse 65, Surah Al-An'am. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also said in the hadith, for if they were not to be ruling by the book of Allah, Allah will send down as a punishment between them, that is to make them split and fight each other. So this is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we left ruling with the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah punished us with this kind of split. This is narrated by Ibn Majah. So to stick to those false loyalties strongly is actually a punishment from Allah because of our sinning and because of our refusal for the truth. Just like Allah did to the Jews. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when Allah tells them, have faith in that which Allah has revealed, they say, we only have faith in that which has been revealed for us, and we disbelieve in everything else. And Allah says, even though what has been revealed to you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the truth, and it approves of the truth that they still have. This is verse 91 from Surah Al-Baqarah. Also, the people in the time of ignorance, the pagan time, the idol worshipping time, when they refused the truth that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with, they used the excuse of loyalty to their ancestors and fathers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about them, if they were told, follow what has been revealed by Allah, they would say, no, but we will follow what we have witnessed as our father's way, or what we have seen as our father's way. This is in verse 170 from Surah Al-Baqarah. So the people of those false loyalties want to make their ways as a substitute for the way of Allah and the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then chapter 9 in the book, the Shaykh speaks about the materialistic look to this life and the disadvantages of this kind of look. First, what is the meaning of the materialistic look? That is, the one's thought is only about obtaining the materials of this life, the gains of this life, the wealth, the money, the food, comfort in this life, and that's all. And all his action would be surrounding those points and going around this. He doesn't exceed that in his thinking, meaning that he has no thought for the hereafter. He has no thought for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared. So all his thought is concentrated about his life, this life. That's all. As if he dies, there's nothing else. This is the meaning of the materialistic life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about those people, خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينَ. They have lost both this life and the hereafter. And there is no worse loss than this, to lose both this life, which you thought that you were achieving it by not thinking about anything else except it, and you lose also the real life, which is the hereafter, the paradise, the heavens. This is in verse 11, Surah Al-Hajj. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly expressed in Quran and shown clearly that he has not created this life for no goal and for just to live it and that's it. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he is the one who created death and life so that he tests you who amongst you has the most righteous action, the most pious. This is in verse 2, Surah Al-Mulk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِيَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. We have made all that which is on earth as a beauty for it, so that we test them, who amongst them is on the right action. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala found this life for us and put in it all kinds of beauty and afflictions and money and children and authority, like being a ruler, being a king, being a prince or whatever. He has put so much things in it. So amongst the people, and that is most of the people, as the Shaykh says, are the one who are narrow-sighted, who look only to those material things that we mentioned. And he makes his joy to achieve those things only, and he doesn't think about the secret behind this life and behind those things. So he would keep busy in achieving those things rather than acting for what is coming later and what is more important. And as a matter of fact, many people totally deny what comes after and totally deny the hereafter. They say that there is no other life but this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about them in Quran, saying, وقالوا إن هي إلا حياتنا الدنيا وما نحن بمبعوثين. There is nothing but this life that we are living in, and we are not going to be resurrected. That's what the kafirs say. And this is verse 29, Surah Al-An'am. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has threatened the people who have such a look for this world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, those who do not wish for meeting with us, that is in the day of judgment, those who do not wish for meeting with us, and rather they become pleased with this down life, meaning this life here in the earth, and they feel secure about it, and they become unaware of our signs, those are the ones whose fate would be hellfire as a punishment for what they have done. This is verses 7 and 8, Surah Yunus. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says also in Quran, he who is concerned about this life and its beauty, Allah will give it to them fully. Meaning in this life, he will give it to them fully. And they will not be made injustice to. But such people would have nothing in the hereafter except hellfire. Would have nothing in the hereafter except hellfire. And all their actions which they have done in this life will be abrogated and cancelled and have no value, because they have not done it for the sake of the hereafter and for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبَاطِلٌ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. What they have been doing is batil, is worthless, because they have not been wishing for the reward from Allah, or they have not been wishing to be resurrected and meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and rewarded. And this kind of threat is valid for anyone who has this materialistic view, whether amongst those who do some actions which are done for the hereafter, like prayers and so on, like hypocrites, they do this, but they do it apparently, and they do it not for the sake of the hereafter, but they do it for the sake of this life, for the sake of being seen and being praised and being looked at as Muslims, so that their blood becomes saved and their souls become saved. So the hypocrites, even though they do some actions of the hereafter, like prayers and so on, but because they are disbelievers in their hearts, they are not doing those actions for the sake of Allah and for the sake of the hereafter. Or the people of Jahiliyyah and the wicked ways and the wrong loyalties, like communists and so on, that we mentioned earlier. So we have two categories, the category of hypocrites and the category of the various loyalties, such as capitalism, atheism, communism, materialism, whatever you call it. And actually, all those categories did not know the true value of this life, and they took this life for a very short-sighted goal, and that is to live it, and that's it. But this is not why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created this life for us. So they were even worse in their looks, because they have abandoned their thoughts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to them as a gift, and they misused their powers, and they wasted their times in that which will not remain for them, meaning this life, and they will not remain for it. This life will neither remain for you, nor you would remain for it. And they did not act for the kind of life which is waiting for them, which is the true life, which they have no way out but to enter it, and that is the life of the hereafter. And the animals doesn't have a fate in the hereafter. Their fate will be death, that's all. And they will turn into dust. And then the kafir, when he sees that happens to the animals, he wishes that he is an animal, because he knows that his fate is going to be everlasting, most severe punishment in hellfire. So when he sees those animals in front of him put to death and put to dust, he says, Ya laytani kuntu turaba, I wish I was dust like them, because then I would not be punished. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran about those kafirs, do you think that most of them truly hear or truly think? They are nothing but like animals. As a matter of fact, they are more astray. More astray. This is verse 44 from Surah Al-Furqan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described those people with ignorance, that those they don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, most of the people are amongst those who don't know. They know only that which pertains to the down life, which is this life, and they are unaware about the hereafter. Verses 6 and 7 from Surah Ar-Rum. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, which the Sheikh here didn't mention, but it supports the meaning of this verse. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah most strongly hates the person, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبْغِضُ كُلَّ جَعْضَرِيٍّ جَوَّاضٍ سَخَّابٍ بِالْأَسْوَاقِ جِيفَةٌ بِالْلَّيْلِ حِمَارٌ بِالنَّهَارِ عَالِمٌ بِأَمْرِ الدُّنْيَا جَاهِلٌ بِأَمْرِ الْآخِرَةِ. This person that the Prophet ﷺ is describing are those kafirs which are mentioned in this verse. That is, they are people which have the qualities that they only know about this life, and they don't know anything about the hereafter, about the paradise, about hellfire, about the sirat, about the scale, about the resurrection. They know nothing. They only know about this life, and they are only concerned about this life. Jifatun fil layl, they sleep like dead people without any movement at night, because they have been so much tired from working in the daytime. Their main concern is this life, and therefore at night they are like dead bodies. No prayers, no remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing. And then himarum bin nahar, the Prophet ﷺ describes them as donkeys in daytime. Himar means a donkey. Donkeys in daytime. A donkey's job is to carry things. No matter what you put on him, he carries, and he just moves on with his job. This is the description of the kafirs that the Prophet ﷺ is giving us, so that we become aware of this, and so that we don't become, unfortunately, a lot of so-called Muslims nowadays have become like this. You find them have no other concern but this life, and all their effort is this life, and they are, as the Prophet ﷺ described them in the hadith, they become like a dead body at night sleeping, and then like a mule or a donkey in the daytime, because they have no concern but this life. So this is the description of the kafir, and not the description of the believer. I have seen in America some people work from 1 hour before Fajr time until 1 hour after midnight, and they call themselves Muslims, yet they do not pray. They don't know any halal and haram. They sell pigs in their stores, they sell wine, alcoholic drinks, things, and so on, every lottery tickets, everything, magazines and things like that. They do everything. So imagine a person like that. He doesn't know anything what's going on about his wife and children and daughter and all this. His daughters will be having American boyfriends, Christian boyfriends. His sons will be indulging in drugs, some of them wearing crosses and having girlfriends all kinds. And he has not even a minute time to look after his responsibilities, and he became like a kafir. Someone who works from 1 hour before Fajr, he wakes up not for Salat al-Fajr, not for prayers, but to drink a coffee and then rush for the job, and then come back 1 hour after midnight and just put his head and sleep, and next day he goes on like that. So despite kafir's expertise in livelihood matters, whether it is manufacturing or technology or whatever, despite all that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has called them, has described them as ignorance and as more astray than animals. Why? And the Prophet ﷺ has described them as donkeys. Why? Because they have not benefited from what they know regarding technology or whatever for the real life and for the real purpose. And that is to please Allah, to worship Allah alone, and to wish for His reward in the hereafter, and to wish for the real life, paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, it is only those who know that they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or it is the scholars who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So their knowledge did not lead them to fear Allah. Their knowledge led them to forget Allah altogether and to wipe out from their hearts the love of Allah, the fear from Allah, and the trust in Allah. It has no remaining of any trace of that in their hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in Quran as an example of those who indulged in this life totally, like Qarun. Qarun was such a person that his wealth could not be counted. In this time, it takes not a billionaire to be like in the position of Qarun, but a trillionaire. A trillionaire who doesn't know how many millions, how many billions he has. Maybe he doesn't even know how many trillions he has. So this is the kind of person that was at that time, in the time of Pharaoh, and that was Qarun. And when he came out feeling full with false pride, and the people who were weak in their faith, when they saw him and they saw all the beauty surrounding him, they said, we wish we have what Qarun has been given, because indeed he has been given a great fortune. And they wished what he had, and they described him that he had a great fortune based on their materialistic view, based on their mere materialistic view. And this is unfortunately the situation nowadays in the kafir countries. They have technological progress, manufactural, economical, and so on. The people with weak faith amongst the Muslims look at them highly and respectfully, and they do not actually look at their real life, what kind of suffering they are going through in their souls in this life, let alone what is waiting for them in the hereafter. Those kafirs nowadays, if you look at the kinds of difficulties that they are living in their hearts, and even in their apparent life, whether it is drugs, whether it is alcohol, whether it is whatever it might be, problems, crimes, whatever it might be, they are having a lot of difficulties also. And yet what is waiting for them in the hereafter is much, much more. This is nothing compared to the hereafter. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the true hadith, that on the day of judgment, the person who has been doing so much ugly things in this life, he would be immersed in hellfire once, and he will be taken out. and then he will be asked, have you seen any happiness? He would forget all the happiness that he had, all the millions, all the cars, all the women, all the whatever he had. He would forget that just by immersing him once in hellfire and taking him out. And then the Sheikh says, the second look to this life is the right look, and that is, the man should look at this life as a means to the real goal, to the real happiness, to the real life. So this life indeed should not be looked at as ugly for itself. No, it could be very good if you use it as a means for pleasing Allah, as a means for the real life, the hereafter. And this life indeed is the life of jihad, the life of prayers, the life of fasting, the life of charity, the life of competing in all good actions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, eat that which you desire and drink that which you desire as a reward for what you have done in the previous days, meaning this life. Actually, joining such sects means kufr, and kufr is opposite to faith and opposite to tawheed. So for someone to join those groups, he would immediately cancel his tawheed. Okay, this is one thing. Another thing is that tawheed has many branches, and amongst those branches are to have the right faith in the hereafter and to have the right look at this life, what is it worth, and to have the right faith in the heavens and hellfire and so on. So if you don't have the right faith in all those things, then you are not a muwahid. As a matter of fact, if you disbelieve in any of those branches of tawheed, like the faith in the heavens, if you have the wrong concept of heavens, let's say you think that heavens is not a materialistic happiness, it is just a mental happiness that you will be rewarded, then you are not believing in the heavens, in paradise. You have to believe in paradise as it is described in Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to indulge into this life totally and to look at your goal as living this life for the sake of this life only, then where is your faith in Allah and His reward? Where is your faith in pleasing Allah? Where is your faith in fearing Allah? Where is your faith in paradise? Where is your faith in resurrection? So this has to do with tawheed a lot and has to do with faith. Plus, our scholars, unlike what some stooges try to picture them, as when they talk about tawheed, they only talk about some aspects of tawheed. No. When our scholars, when they speak about tawheed, they speak about a comprehensive understanding of tawheed. And this is a comprehensive understanding, you see. For example, what is opposite to tawheed? It's not to supplicate to the walis. Not only that. This is one thing which contradicts tawheed and takes you out of Islam. But if you become a communist, then you are like the one who has supplicated to the walis, and you are like the one who has gone around graves. No difference. If you become socialist, if you become whatever, yani those groups, then you are like those people who supplicate to the awliya, or the one who goes around the grave. No difference, you see, no difference. So Ahl Sunnah have the comprehensive explanation of Tawheed. The innovators are narrow-minded when they speak about Tawheed. You find a group in which they only speak about what we spoke today as Tawheed. And when they hear someone forbidding people from supplicating to the awliya, they mock him and they look down at him and they belittle him. Like Muhammad Surur, for example, he says that our da'wah has unfortunately been tested with such people who forbid the poor people from supplicating to the awliya and going around the graves, okay, and forget about the other forms of shirk or something like this that he says. You see, so he is considering it a misfortune for his da'wah. Of course, for his da'wah, because his da'wah to tawheed is short. His da'wah to tawheed is just to look at certain things, ruling and things like that. You see, so he considers our scholars who have the comprehensive look, like now you see by your own eyes, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan spoke about supplicating to the awliya, and also some other subjects regarding this will come. But he did not forget Hakimiyya. He did not forget enrolling into those parties. You see? So this is a refutation for those people. For those ignorant people, actually. They are ignorant. They are ignorant because anyone who thinks that calling people to worshipping Allah alone and not to supplicate to other than Allah, anyone who considers this action to be a misfortune for him and for his da'wah, then his da'wah is fake. And his da'wah is not tawheed. His da'wah is something else, whatever it might be. Yeah. No. This has been expressed in Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَابْتَغِي فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدار الآخرة ولا تنس نصيبك من الدنيا. This is the balance. This is the exact balance. Seek with all that Allah has given you, health, money, good body, whatever, seek with all that the hereafter. Make your main goal the hereafter. As the Prophet ﷺ said, in the time of health, do actions which please Allah, because when you become sick, you cannot do. In the time of richness, do actions which you cannot do in the time of poverty, and so on. So this is the balance. But Allah said at the end of the verse, after saying, seek with all that Allah has given you, the hereafter, He said, what? وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Don't forget your share in this life. So you can see that taking your share in this life is minor in comparison to the real thing, and that is seeking the hereafter, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, they indulged into this life, but not to the degree that they placed it in their heart. They had it in their hand. They had it in their hands. They could control it. That's the meaning. It would not control them. If it's in your heart, then it controls you. You want to go to Salat, but see, the heart is the king. If life places in your heart, then it becomes your king, and it will lead you to destruction. You want to make prayer, that will divert you. You want to make charity, it will remind you that you will be poor and things like that, you know, because this has become the dynamo for you, the goal for this life only, the materialistic look. So this is the right way to balance. The companions, when they conquered the world and a lot of booties came from the kafirs to them, they built castles. They had castles because they had a lot of money. Yani as a reward for them, booties in the battles. They had so much money, so much gold, so much. They were counting by millions that time, millions, you see. The woman, Aisha radiallahu anha, was fasting one day, and before breaking the fast, her share from one battle, even though she was not fighting, they gave her like something like $250,000 of dirhams. Okay. So she immediately distributed everything. She even forgot to buy something for breaking the fast. You see, she had $250,000 in her hand. In her hand, not in her heart. And she spent it like just like that. Huh? And the servant reminded her that we need something to break the fast with. Didn't you save 2 dirhams for our breakfast to break the fast? She said, had you reminded me, I would have saved a few dirhams, 5 dirhams. But you haven't reminded me. So this was the way of the companions. May Allah be pleased with them. The prophets, all the prophets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them to eat that which is beautiful for them, and to drink that which is beautiful, and to dress that which is beautiful. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers also, and he told us that you deserve this in this life, and in the hereafter you have more, okay, much more, okay. So we are not like Christians who say that piety is to seclude yourself from the life and not even taste anything good in it, and go and seclude yourself in the church or whatever and stay there. This is not Islam. This is not Islam. And the companions used to eat everything that was halal, beautiful. They would eat it if they had it. Okay? They would not abstain. قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي أَخْرَجَ لِلنَّاسِ وَالطَّيِّبَاتِ مِنَ الرِّزْقِ. Say, who is to make haram that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a beauty for the people and the good provision? No one can make it haram. This is in Quran. And just like Allah said to the messengers, eat that which is good, he told the believers, eat that which is good and dress that which is good and enjoy that which is good. Okay? And in Islam, a man has the right to marry 4 women, right? Why? 4 women, not one. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not want for us to suffer and this and that. No. He puts us into some sufferings as a test. Good for us. We have higher ranks. But he did not order us to stay away from this dunya totally and this and that. No. No.
Coming back to chapter 8, parties, ignorance. Towards the end of the chapter, there is a hadith that says, unless their rulers rule by the book of Allah,
no,
Allah would turn their own mind against them.
Yeah, this is a punishment. Yani we were talking about what? Allegiances and parties, false allegiances, false parties, false loyalties. This is one of the causes of this kind of punishment, huh? Is not to rule with the rule of Allah, is to have some kind of rulers with man-made rulings.
Their own might means?
Huh?
Their own might means people can...
Yeah, we fight each other. You see, Muslims become sects and parties, they fight each other. They slander each other, backbite each other, they kill each other, they classify each other, huh? It's a punishment. This is true. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لا حلف في الإسلام. لا حلف في الإسلام. There should be no kind of subcontracts, treaties within Islam itself. Islam is a contract. We are all Muslims. We are one party. So when we come and say, we have such and such party and such and such party, even if it's in the name of Islam, this is not true, because this would lead to split amongst Muslims. It would lead to false allegiances. Huh? Everyone aligns himself to certain thing and becomes very strong in his allegiance to the degree that he might reject the truth, he might hate his other brothers. This is not right. Whatever causes the split of the Muslims is haram. Because unity of Muslims is a great thing. Therefore, we cannot accept any kind of parties. No parties at all.